My name is Sydney Lindquist.
And I'm Grace Maddock.
And this is RJTV.
With prom season upon us, you must have seen countless photos of girls in pretty dresses. But have you ever wondered how much a dress costs?
We sent reporters Brooke Tobias and my co-host, Grace Maddock, to figure out just how much prom costs.
In the spirit of prom, myself, Brooke Tobias, and my fellow reporter, Grace Maddock, went into the girls' and boys' divisions of Regis Jesuit High School to ask some students questions. The first question we asked students is how much do they think the average prom dress costs?
Like $120.
What is that?
Like $200?
I think like a typical prom dress is like $200.
$125.
Students were very surprised to find out that the average cost of a prom dress is $400.
Nice. $400.
Really?
$400.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
$400. That's like the average.
That's a lot of money.
The next question we asked was how much did they think the boys' prom attire cost?
Like $120.
Probably about $50 if I have to buy a tie because I have my own tux.
$100.
$90?
The third question we asked students was if they would ever make the girl pay for the prom ticket.
No.
No?
No.
Maybe.
I get free ones for a student council, so.
Prom's expensive.
The last question we asked was kind of funny, and we were wondering what the students were wearing to prom.
The tuxedo, shoes, basically, yeah, and then...
I'm actually wearing a prom dress, just like a normal one.
I think I'm just gonna wear like a bear suit, honestly. I mean, I think I kind of want that, like, really looks nice, like, dry clean it.
After its recent renovations, tons of amazing stories take place at Denver Union Station, just like 100 years ago.
We sent our reporters, Fernanda Romo and Maria Jose Macias, to find out more about the story behind this landmark.
Yes, it is one of the oldest. It's not the oldest. Like I said, downtown Denver. What's unique about downtown Denver is most cities in America are all built on north, south, east, and west. And Denver's not because they had the river that comes through here. So they had to adjust the streets. Used to have Amtrak, mainly the only train that was coming in. It used to have a trolley system along with the passenger trains. But the trains would come in from the south and then exit out through the north, where now they only come in from the north, they back up into the station and they leave to the north.
Union Station has witnessed many interesting stories.
Back during World War II, the building next to Crawford Hotel, the old Union Station, it's called the Ice House. And when soldiers were killed during World War II, they stored their bodies in there, and then they were transported by train into Crawford and then across the street to keep them cool until the families could come pick them up. So, and then also there was a fire inside the old Union Station where I think it was 21 people died, and they also say that this little girl was the one that started the fire. And then inside the station, well, I don't think they'll let you have access to the area. There are some of the beams there that still are burned from that fire.
In 2012, it underwent a major renovation and it reopened in the summer of 2014 with the addition of the Crawford Hotel, several restaurants and retailers, and a train hall.
And I live 4 hours away. I used to live here, so when I lived in Boulder, I used the buses more often. It's great. It's really nice, really pleasant, easy to get around. I'm glad to see the light rail go into the airport. And while I was in Denver, I took the light rail around as well, and that was really convenient and fast.
This is Maria Jose Macias and Fernanda Romo for RJTV.
The Midnight Club is definitely a band that you should add to your playlist.
Lead singer Junior Owen Coleman discusses with his bandmates the struggles of living double lives as students and band members.
RJTV reporters Kelsey Hayes and Alejandra Pineda bring us the story behind the Midnight Club.
Welcome to the Jazz Age! The Midnight Club offers a unique sound created by four high schoolers, Henry Lovelace, Sean McCarthy, Harry Springer, and Regis Jr., Owen Coleman. Knowing obstacles would appear down the road, the members of the band chose to face the challenges. Lead guitarist Harry would consider music to be the most important and influential thing in his lifestyle.
8 a.m. to 3 p.m. is school, and 3 p.m. onwards is practice.
The music video for Should Have Held Me Tighter took an extensive time of planning, and after weeks, it is all brought together. Henry, rhythm guitarist, describes it as a more difficult challenge, but enjoys what he does.
That's hard because I actually have a job too, but I manage it. You know, I like working a lot and doing everything I can.
Sean, the drummer of the band, it is not so hard.
I have two off periods, and so I kind of get a lot of work done during that. Plus, like, with my classes, it's kind of like a reversed schedule, and so I don't really get that much homework, so it's not that big of a deal.
Owen Coleman, the lead singer of the band, faces these challenges every day, but continues to do what he loves.
It's really hard and it is really challenging, but it's something I love doing, you know, music in general, and being in a band is something I've always, you know, really aspired to be in and do music in general. So even though it's hard to juggle school and family and the band, you know, you find time for everything because you just love it.
That was awesome. Seriously sick.
Yeah,
this video is really good.
I think the music video went absolutely spectacular. I think we killed it today. It's a very unique and different video from the Knockback music video, and I think the viewers are going to be very entertained when they watch it.
Kelsey Hayes and Alejandra Pineda reporting for RJTV.
The Regis Jesuit community strives to be accepting and loving to everyone that comes to our campus.
Each year we welcome diversity into our community through the exchange program with our sister school in Guadalajara, Mexico.
Today we learn more about the exchange students and their experiences in America.
Hi, my name is Bernardo Orozco.
I'm Juan Pablo Villaseñor.
My name is Fernanda Romo.
My name is María José. They call me Majo.
I'm Monse.
I'm Ana.
I'm Javier Villarreal. I'm exchange student from Guadalajara.
When asked about their experiences in a new country, this group of Mexican exchange students had a lot to say about American culture and the daily life here at Regis Jesuit.
I was part of the play. That was awesome. I loved it. I got to meet a lot of awesome people there.
You have different restaurants, like Sonic and like Chick-fil-A and stuff. We don't have that.
Hamburgers. Yeah, really. It's different. Like, I don't know why, but it's different from Mexico.
I feel like the sky is more blue here. Mm-hmm. And like, in our city, we have buildings everywhere, so we cannot like appreciate the sky as much, and here you have the most beautiful sunsets.
Having the mountains here, having those things here like so close, it's like really, really nice.
However, their times in America have not been without struggle. They've encountered issues surrounding language barriers, homesickness, and even cultural conflict.
It's hard to think about that because it's a great school, great country, but like I think like I don't like when the people talk about Mexicans in the bad way, you know? And I think like that is one of the hardest things.
To get used to the new family, you know? Like, well, I love my host family, but it's hard, you know? Because you don't know them and you're just living there for 5 months. So yeah, that's hard.
It's in English, so it's sometimes, it's hard, but we like it.
Ultimately, these students are grateful to be here, and the memories they have made will stay with them for the rest of their lives.
Like, I remember our first weeks, a lot of girls will come up to us and, like, talk and introduce themselves, and they will tell us that it was really cool that we, like, came from another place and stuff.
Kairos. Yeah, we went, like, three. We went, well, for me, it was, like, the amazing experience I ever had here, so, yeah.
It's exciting when they want to know about Mexico because they ask you everything, and it's cool. I mean, it's been great.
This is Nina Nieto and Anna Gamito with RJTV.
Even after 60 years, two Holocaust survivors, Eric Kahn and Jack Adler, have incredible stories and messages to tell.
We sent reporters Molly Moran and my co-host Sydney Lindquist to hear their stories and share them with young people.
My name is Eric Kahn. I live in Denver,
Rufus.
Eric Kahn now lives a normal life, but little do people know he is a Holocaust survivor.
I try to do with my life each and every day is to live by the golden rule, to do unto others as I would have them do unto me.
Hello, my name is Jack Adler, A-D-L-E-R, and I was born in Pabianice, Poland. Well, anyhow, I was 10 years old when the Holocaust started. I'm the sole survivor of my entire immediate family. I spent 5 years and 8 months in the Holocaust, in two ghettos and three concentration camps.
These two men not only share a similar past, but also a philosophy on life they think should be shared with young people.
Yeah, I believe in mutual respect. I don't believe in hate, and it will not stop until we live by the golden rule. Do unto others as you like them to do unto you.
The next time they hear something like this, to stand up and not let it be said and say, this is not okay with me. And if each of us will do that over and over and over again, we can make our schools, our neighborhoods, our communities, our state, and our country a better place in which to live.
You don't have to love me. You don't have to like me. Just respect me as a fellow human being.
This is Sydney Lindquist and Molly Moran for RJTV.
As you may already know, May is the official month for mental health. This year's theme is Life with a Mental Illness, and we'll focus on individuals sharing what life with a mental illness feels like for them.
Throughout the month, people will post in words, pictures, or videos with the hashtag Mental Illness Feels Like.
RJTV reporter Jennifer Menjivar went out to get the story on mental illness and how it affects some students at Regis Jesuit.
What are your thoughts on mental illness?
Well, it's definitely something I struggle with and a lot of my friends struggle with, and it's more prominent in today's society because they know more about it today than they did 20, 40, 100 years ago.
It's definitely something that I know a lot of people suffer from, but not a lot of people like actually know they are suffering from it, and then it's like a lesser known like illness amongst like a lot of people. And it's just not treated as like a physical illness would be.
Well, I was just recently diagnosed with a mental illness. Before that, I kind of thought that it was like something people could just like, if they worked hard enough, they could get over it with like within like a few months. But actually having a mental illness, that's changed where like I understand more, and I just don't think someone without a mental illness can really understand fully how it affects one until they have one themselves.
When it comes to it, hopefully you're more open and like willing to talk to your friends about it, because even if you're not getting like help from like a therapist or a doctor, your friends will most likely be like helpful in that And it's like really important to have a good support group. Even if your family isn't that supportive of like any of this, you should be able to have friends who are with you for it.
Basketball may not be America's pastime, but every year people go mad for it in March. Four games were played here in downtown Denver.
Sports analyst Kate Clausen and Clara DaCosta interviewed some crazed fans to get their take on the tournament.
Hundreds of fans from all over gathered for the first round games of the NCAA tournament in downtown Denver.
I'm a big Utah fan. I graduated from Utah.
We're just passing through on the way back from Palm Springs.
They filled out brackets in anticipation for the games.
All my brackets are busted.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So yeah, I'm screwed. I donate my money in the office pool, so it's okay.
Utah's not in the Final Four. Sorry, so although I wish they should be. Because everybody else I had in the Final Four is lost.
I haven't had a busted bracket yet. Although I'm looking good.
Yeah, I'm doing better than him. That's all that matters.
These dedicated fans each had their favorite game of the tournament.
Probably the Little Rock, Arkansas game.
The UNI game last night where they won at the buzzer.
Oh, the Purdue game.
The Purdue loss was awesome. That was our highlight.
Back at Regis Jesuit, March Madness has also reached the students.
March Madness is when college basketball gets to the final tournament in the NCAA tournament, and everyone fills out a bunch of brackets to see who wins, and it's like you win money if your bracket is the best.
Each of these enthusiastic fans brought their unique bracketology methods.
Usually just if I know the school or if I don't.
My dad actually made the bracket for me.
I use Kate's bracket that she fills out as my own.
How is that doing?
Terrible.
Sorry.
I don't know how much of an influence the name has on a team's playing.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, when you have a name like Chattanooga, you're going to win.
This is Kate Clausen and Claire DaCosta, RJ Media.
We hope you enjoyed the stories on today's episode of RJ TV.
We'll see you next time. I'm Grace Maddock.
And I'm Sydney Lindquist.
For RJTV.